I first heard of Joe in 2021 when COVID was going on. 2020?
I think probably.
Okay, through
Even before that.
Through a mutual friend of mine called Taylor Kendall, whom I never met, but we knew each other online, and we kind of, then he contributed something, a chapter to a book I was doing on the post-truth society, what happens when truth doesn't matter anymore. And Joe and I were having a bad hair day on this day, as you can see, okay? So you can see my, I have put on probably too much wax on my hair. And it was about 8 o'clock in the morning when you and I were kind of riffing of this thing. And Taylor said, you need to speak to this guy at some stage. And I can't remember whether we spoke before this thing happened. Okay. And I guess when I started speaking to Joe, and specifically when I watched Social Dilemma, a lot of things started to, you know, like the penny dropped, I think.
Yeah, why don't you just go ahead, yeah, sit down and if you can get comfy. You good? All right.
Yeah.
Take one, marker.
Do you want to just start by introducing yourself?
You good?
This is the worst part, man. I don't like this.
I worked at Facebook in 2011 and 2012.
I was one of the really early employees at Instagram.
I worked at Twitter. My last job there was the senior vice president of engineering.
I was the president of Pinterest. Before that, I was the director of monetization at Facebook for 5 years.
While at Twitter, I spent a number of years running their developer platform and then became head of consumer product.
I was the co-inventor of Google Drive, Gmail Chat, Facebook Pages, and the Facebook Like button.
Yeah, this is why I spent like 8 months talking back and forth with like lawyers. It freaks me out.
When I was there, I always felt like fundamentally it was a force for good. I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
I left Google in June 2017 due to ethical concerns, and not just at Google, but within the industry at large.
It's easy today to lose sight of the fact that these tools actually have created some wonderful things in the world. They've reunited lost family members. They found organ donors. I mean, there were meaningful systemic changes happening around the world because of these platforms that were positive. I think we were naive about the flip side of that coin.
And I think when people come to my lectures, I teach new media at university. Some people are coming expecting that they're going to become SEO specialists or social media gurus or whatever it is, and they find that I'm teaching critical approaches to new media. It doesn't mean that I've crossed to the other side and said that everything that is bad. I can't do without the internet. So I'm completely, you know, freaked out. I mean, the worst thing which can happen to you in Malta is either you have electricity power outage, and then the next thing is that you would probably have no internet. So, the book that you may have picked up, we may riff about at some stage. I know we're using it not just as a textbook where I teach, but it's also been translated in several languages, and it's being used as an activist project in Sweden and in Italy. That's good. Yeah, we're good. That's brilliant. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay. So, the other thing I can tell you is that what we're interested in, and I'm soon going to shut up, are three things, but which you will find in our conversation with Joe, us guys, we're interested in three things. One is media freedoms, whatever it means, whatever media means these days, whatever it means to be free on the media, because as far as I'm concerned, this is media. Disinformation, whatever that means, because you can go from disinformation and malinformation, as my friend was saying, direction I was talking about. And the other thing, if you're a parent like I am, understanding human behavior and how it's changed ever since people started navigating their lives via screens, I guess. This is a bit of an eye test, especially those of you who are at the back, but maybe I'm really fond of cartoons and the visual arts, and I'm very pleased I'm teaching some digital arts people. I don't know if you can see that behind Joe's head, there's somebody who's like, probably a parent looking up on the hourglass. You know, the time is running out. There isn't much left. Then on the other side, there's a lot of time left over there. I think increasingly, I am finding that as somebody who's age 62, but he's been in love with the internet for the last 20, whatever it is, I'm struggling when I am teaching, consulting to people who are much younger. So the reason why Sophie and Alex are over here, okay, specifically these guys, you're millennials, right? So you two are millennials. What are you now? You're Gen Z, right? So these are the really complicated guys, okay? The whole Gen Z guys, okay? So, and then, you know, probably this is my last slide. Probably it's my last slide. It's the same slide by, I mean, it's the same cartoonist, the guy called Yuval Rob. Probably some mom who's like, looking at the screen. I think her daughter is looking at the screen. But the baby in the pram is reading a book. So make of that what you wish, okay? And then from that point onwards, I'm very happy to leave you in the good hands of my friend Joe Toscano.
Right. Thank you. Thank you all for showing up. I'll do a quick introduction myself, and then I'm going to do about a 15-minute presentation about the work I do and hopefully help open your mind. I know they're going to have some questions, but I also hope that you all have questions. I've spoken about these issues for the last 7 years, 6.5, 7 years, around the globe. Thousands of people, schools, businesses, big conferences, been everywhere. My background, I was a consultant for Google. My last full-time job, I was a UX designer. What that means is that I design the interfaces that you use at Google and how you experience it. Now, if you're not familiar with design, there's a whole art to it that has got more prominence in the last decade or so called persuasive design, and it is the blend of psychology and consumer behavior into user interfaces, and that is a lot of what we spoke about in the movie. My background, though, I was very good at math as a kid. I come from Nebraska, which, if you don't know the United States well, that's the middle of the country. When I grew up, I was 5-10 minutes from farmland, pretty well disconnected from a lot of things, the internet. My state probably be 10 or 15 years behind the average city or state on the coast. So I kind of lived in this world of analog and unconnected most of my life. I didn't even have a smartphone until I was 22. You know, I think they actually started to come out into the world when I was maybe like 13 or 14, so I was pretty late for my age. Anyway, I was very good at math, and when I went into college, they said, you should be a math professor, to which my 18-year-old brain said, no, and I'm gonna try to do something else, but wanted to keep my math skills. So I got into psychology, and I thought, I'm going to make myself well-rounded. You know, I've peaked at mathematics. There's nothing better I can do because math professors are really boring. If I were born in California, though, they probably would have said, go build computers, go design algorithms and stuff like that. But that's an example of like how far behind my home state was, right? We just didn't even have the language for it. Anyway, as a sophomore, junior, I was doing graduate-level statistics and research, paid as a graduate. And I just realized, you know, I didn't really want to do academic theory for the rest of my life. I was very interested in getting a PhD in behavioral economics, but then I realized, yeah, I just like don't really enjoy the day-to-day research life. I'd rather go put this into some kind of service or product. You know, my parents are entrepreneurs, my grandpa's an entrepreneur. I thought I want to go put this in a service or product that can benefit the world. And it was just about the same time that, you know, there's an app for that was everywhere. So I took my math skills and I applied it to learning code. I picked up one class, maybe I guess 1.5 classes if you call it that, about how to code at university, and then mostly self-taught from there. So I went from data science to engineering, spent the first half decade of my career writing code, and then very quickly realized that if I don't start to learn some of these deeper artificial intelligence, machine learning, all these buzzwords you probably heard, eventually the code that I'm writing is going to write itself, which is where we are today. So I moved into design at that point, which is much more about how does information flow from one place to the other, How do people use this information? How do we make it work for people? That was when I got my role at Google, actually, not too long after that, as a designer. Because I was one of the few designers at that point in history that was capable of coding and designing and speaking business. You know, normally you have a designer who's very good at making things decorative and engaging, but doesn't really know how it's built. So it takes a lot more back and forth between teams, and that costs the company more money, you know, et cetera, et cetera. I could bridge that. I could speak to both teams. I could help direct things, make things move faster and cheaper. And that was what I built my career upon. About 6 to 8 months in at Google, I started to realize the scale, the size of what I was doing, the impact, you know. You're building for billions of people, not just like, oh, I built an app that my family uses. Like 2 billion people use it, you know. And you think about the way that people use it in different languages, in different states of internet connectivity, so many different ways of thinking about how it's used. We didn't really do a lot of creative work as much as we did big picture accessibility and for lack of better words, like legal standards, how to make things safer, really. My belief, my practice when I left was never to speak poorly about Google or these companies in terms of like trying to tear them down. I think there's a lot of good work that's been done by these companies. I know that they are more or less the infrastructure for the modern world, right? We were speaking earlier, what happens when Netflix goes down? You see Twitter just blow up. Everybody's talking about Netflix is down. There's problems everywhere. It's just Netflix, though. What if Google went down? You know, you wouldn't have Chrome browser. You wouldn't have email. You wouldn't have a map. You know, you would be back in 1995, basically. Anyway, I didn't leave because I think they're malicious or that they're trying to harm people. I left because I felt that there was just bad data science. And that's because of my academic background and the training I saw. And the questions they were asking were very leading, which in a company that's billions of dollars in value and, you know, arguably more powerful than a lot of governments, becomes problematic at a monopoly level. When you can ask a question that gets the answer you want, and then when people ask about that question, you can give them the data that validates what you want them to hear, right? Yeah, so that's why I left. After leaving, I spoke out. I traveled anywhere that would have me. At first, I didn't really know what I was doing, to be honest with you. I was just like, there's a problem. We need to speak about this. I had a following on social media, so I wasn't like totally crazy, but I sold everything I own, hopped into my two-door coupe, and I just kind of went, drove anywhere that would have me. I broke my lease in San Francisco and everything, lived out of my car for like 2.5 months, and just built a grassroots network of people that would like hear me out, because this was a time in history where the things I was speaking about, people would literally tell me, just like, that's not real. Go home, you know, stay at your parents' house, put your tinfoil hat on and hide away. You know, I've had journalists, I was speaking to Reuters in 2018. I told them the same thing that I tell all the national news broadcasts today, almost exactly the same words. But the difference is now people believe me, right? It took a long time of pushing on this. And I was, as you saw in the film, I was pretty nervous about it. You know, I come from a blue collar family. My parents were postal workers who started their own business 10 years into my life. My cousins, uncles are, you know, plumbers, electricians. We don't have money to fight these companies. I never thought they were going to come try to kill me. People are like, oh, were you scared they're going to come kill you? No. I was scared that they were going to sue me so bad I'd want to die, you know. And that's a real thing. So, yeah, it's been quite the journey. Since the book published, the book's called Automating Humanity. We're at a point where we are automating everything that is human, but also we're still at a point where we can make it humane. We are not locked into whatever dark future everybody's painting in the world. It's a possibility, for sure, if we don't take control of things. But it's not guaranteed. We can make change. And that book got me traveling all around the globe. I spent about 2.5 years just everywhere that would have me. And I'm talking, I was going everywhere. It was waking up sober, not knowing where I was, because it was just so many different time zones and hotels and everything. Eventually, I got connected to the people writing the movie, and they interviewed me. The 3 or so minutes that I was actually in the film was probably my lowest level of impact. I actually handed them my book, and I said, hey, look, this is what you need to make this thing look like if you want people to listen, right? Because you know, being from Nebraska, I spent my whole life trying to translate these issues to my family who had no technical background, right? To give you another example in Nebraska, like, I'd fly home from San Francisco to Nebraska to go teach. 2017 in San Francisco, I go get lunch, I tap my phone, I walk away with my food, and it's just normal. Right. In Nebraska, I'd fly home, it's a 6-hour flight, it's like I went 15 years back in time. I would go to a sandwich shop, tap my phone, and I literally got chased out the store because they thought I was stealing. You know. So yeah, I spent my whole life basically trying to explain these things, and I simplified it. And my book is 230 pages, but it's only really about 120 of writing. The rest of it's visualized. I'm also I'm a very visual learner. I'm not very good at listening. That made me a really terrible student. I had decent GPA, but if you ask my professors, not a good student. I just don't learn from sitting and listening to lectures. I'm very hands-on, I'm very visual, and I expressed everything in visuals and through artwork. And I went to the Social Dilemma crew and I said, hey, look, if you have a bunch of talking heads about this kind of stuff, it's just going to go everyone's hat. You know, you gotta have some kind of story behind this. You gotta have some visuals about it. And I think they did a wonderful job expressing the story. I think that's why it clicked. Before that movie, but also just in the whole path of this, I suppose. I've advised U.S. state-level attorneys general, about 35 of them, on antitrust cases, on monopoly law, on Facebook and Google. I've helped draft privacy laws in a couple different states. I have helped actually draft a data taxation system in the state of New York, which was supported by Paul Romer, former chief economist of the World Bank. So there's definitely interest and understanding in this future that we've been pushing on. What that's led me to, and what I'll talk to you a little bit about today, is I am CEO of a new company called DataGrade. I've been working on this for quite some time and in different iterations, but this company, the purpose is to monitor, evaluate, and assess risk and value of data on the internet and how it's transacted. The premise basically is that data is money, and that's what I'm going to speak to you about real quickly. So to start this presentation, I just want to hand raise how many of you in the last 5 years or so believe that at one point you have been listened to by Google? It's actually a lot less than I expected, but yeah, that's the point, right? A lot of us feel that way. Whether it's Google or Facebook or whatever, you're like, they definitely heard me. Have you ever considered, though, that actually maybe they're not listening? Because plenty of studies have come out, they're not. Have you considered maybe that actually there's so much data out there about you that they're just attuned to your behavior that it feels like they're listening? Yeah? I think we're all pretty familiar with these cameras that are around the world in businesses, in stores, on walls in cities, what may be. We're all familiar with this being surveillance, right? And whether you like it or not, you know, it's part of your life and you kind of maybe have given up at this point trying to get around them, but you know, there's still people who do. A lot of people, though, haven't considered, for example, when you check in on the train, on the tube, every time you use your phone to tap and buy anything, that's also tracking you. It's not just a transaction fee that's going through. It's your location. It's the store that you're at and what things you may be purchasing and what interests you may have based on consumer purchase intent. A lot of different things come through with those simple transactions. Most of you probably haven't considered the fact that these new interactive screens you're seeing everywhere for movies or advertisements that are on bus stops, on the walls at the theater, they are aware of how close you are to them. They can tell about how tall you are. They can see how long you stood in front of them. There is surveillance everywhere that's tracking things you're not quite aware of. How about the books you read? You're on a Kindle, right? You can see how far in a book you are. You can see what you highlight on certain versions of different reading devices. You can see all the books you buy and save and how fast you read and all these different things to tell different things about you. Your thermometer at your house, it can tell probably when you wake up, when you come home from work, when you go to bed, and maybe other things that you have it programmed. Although it may not be that exact thing, it might not be labeled for work. We pair it with other location systems or check-ins at work, and we know, yeah, that was within this time period. We can make pretty good estimates about what's going on in your life. Roombas. Roombas were pretty safe devices. I remember them coming out, and it was like magic, like something. I don't like vacuuming. But nowadays, they're tracking inside your house, right? They can map your floor plan. And those that have cameras have been found to actually be taking video, photos, people inside their house. But even if you don't have Roomba, you have Wi-Fi. And nowadays, Wi-Fi can also map your home, just the signal coming out of your routers, which most people don't know about. It's everywhere. You've put this in your home willfully, and we never had a right to say no. In part, we never had a right, and in part, we never knew. And that's part of what bothered me and why I left. But what I'm bringing up here is not to scare you. It's to simply say, you know, when you think of it, maybe Google or Facebook, because I think that's one of the biggest problems with talking about privacy and data literacy is so many people only recognize it from the frame of Google or Facebook. The reality is it's everywhere. It's everything you touch creates data nowadays. And whether you give Google or Facebook or whoever access to it or not, they can get it from somewhere else probably at this point in history, and that's legal. There's nothing wrong with that outside of a breach of your trust and your privacy. Nothing legally incorrect. Now that's Google, but I want to bring up another example just to kind of validate that fact, okay? My company, DataGrade, we ran an analysis on the California Department of Motor Vehicles to find out what organizations they're sharing data with. We found a lot. Not only their standard trackers that you find, but also insurance companies, NHTS, the National Highway Safety stuff. They share data with a lot of people, so much so that it turns out a couple years ago they made $50 million off people's personal information in a year. The DMV, where I go and give my government identity and get my licenses and my titles for my car, which you think is just there to service you as a tax-paid service, is becoming a for-profit entity with our personal data, right? Now, it's not just California, because California's on tech, so of course you think California's doing it. I also found it in Florida, South and North Carolina, and the more you dig, it's just about every DMV in the United States. Now, guaranteed, this is happening over here too. Now, I don't know, Malta as well, and perhaps it's not quite as connected, but I guarantee, what's gonna end up happening is every organization on the planet right now is digitizing, especially since COVID. They were literally forced into making themselves digital. And with that, every business is going to be digital first. Every product that you purchase is going to be, or attempt to be, connected to the internet. That means more data from more places in ways that you've never considered. And you may consider it to happen in one way, and the developer who built the tool may think of something totally different. So you won't actually know what's really happening because, again, you have no rights. In Europe, you do have more rights, but like you still have base level, very little rights, and we have no legal requirement for these companies to report anything. That's one of the biggest things I push for. I actually don't agree with trying to control how they use data. I think that sharing data is one of the most valuable things that we can do on the internet, and it's also one of the things that makes the internet useful to us. So the talk that I'm bringing here today is called Invisible Threads. Just started doing this last week. This is one of the first times I've actually given this talk, and I hope that I can take this out to more people. But the point is this: while sharing is what makes the internet, right? Data going place to place, creating what we literally call the web, it's also the greatest risk to our privacy, and we should have rights to understand it better. So bring me back to DataGrade. I told you what we do is we analyze and assess risk and value on the internet. And because we believe, fundamentally, that data is money. Now, how many of you have heard the term attention economy? A handful? Okay. So the whole point of the attention economy, if you haven't heard of it, is that companies, these companies, and a few more, a lot more, they make their money not from us paying them, but from us paying attention. Right. Think of the English language itself, what I just said there. We pay attention. Okay. The theory that I brought to the antitrust regulators in the United States, because so many of them are confused about what's happening here, they don't understand how these companies make money and why it works the way it does. Okay. In the U.S., antitrust law, historically, legal precedents in the last 50 years, is that if a service is getting cheaper, that's what's best for consumers. So what that means in the current market and the way they look at these companies is, if it's free, that must be the best, right? The problem is they haven't considered how money is made on the internet. In this new attention economy, these companies have thrown the fiscal economy out the window and said, we are going to operate in our own space, this attention economy. What they do is they get you to pay attention through clicks, engagements, comments, sharing, all the different things. That then turns into data, and then that data turns into money, profit, revenues. Now, if you know money laundering law in the United States, I don't know how many of you know, but the way it works is you're turning illegitimate assets into cash or a legitimate asset. This is not so different, right? We take an illegitimate asset of attention, turn it into an illegitimate asset of data, which I think can be legitimized, but is not, and then turn it into a legitimate asset of cash. So what we're looking at, the reason why they have so much power and money is because, more or less, they've created their own marketplace, they run their own rules on it, nobody has any insider transparency into it, and they name their price. It is more or less a money laundering scheme, and these companies are more or less mafia. That was my biggest concern when I left, that data was being misused and misrepresented in terms of its value, and that it would cause trauma to our economies around the globe, not only through politics and media, as we've seen and we're going to discuss a bit today, but also just financial repercussions and losing jobs and replacing systems that we always thought would be in place but are now crumbling before our eyes. The other thing I bring up is if data is money, why do we treat data so differently than we treat our financial transactions, right? How many of you in the room either run a business or understand like the way that businesses operate from a profit and loss stance, all the, you know, finances, right? Okay, those of you who do, wouldn't it be insane if you just took all that and threw it out the window and said, you know what, there was some money and it went there, and there was some parts and it went there, there was some, we're not sure how much, but there's some. That's about how data works right now, right? Why, when we talk about data, does all this go out the window? Okay. If you talk about Facebook, for example, last year Facebook was in front of Congress and Congress had asked them, what data do you store on us? You know, what precisely do you have and where is it? To which the director of engineering said, you know, I don't think there's a single person who could tell you that. But we could do it if we had a team, right? So here's what he said, basically. He said, number one, we have no idea what's happening with our data, where it is, how it's going. Part of that's a problem of, like, it's a massive ship to uncover all that stuff, right? You're trying to clean up an oil spill in the ocean. It's all out there. It's mixed in. It's really hard to decipher what is where. Part of it is they just didn't build it to be managed. They built it to just suck in as much data as possible and figure it out later. But the second point that he said there is that we could do it if we had a team. So, i.e., it's possible, we don't have the budget to do it, and we don't have a financial incentive to do it, right? And that's what needs to change. The biggest thing I push for in law is not controlling how data is used, but actually that they should have to report how much data are they collecting, what types of data are they collecting, who is it being shared with, how is it allowed to be used, for how long, things like that, just like we report our taxes. Right? Data should be looked at the same way. I'll talk about financial repercussions that businesses are seeing, reputational, and also consumer trust, which is probably the layer in which we all engage today. From a financial perspective, now, a lot of you probably are familiar, you're all Europeans, you understand that there's new laws being stood up all over Europe to protect your privacy, and that's good. It's a good first step. Europe created a global conversation that we needed to have. This here, if you look at this tiny little green dot, that's a visual to scale, visual representation of the volume of fines that were in the EU through the GDPR in 2018. It's about $500,000. This next bigger circle is a visual of the near $3 billion that is cumulative as of 2022. So you're talking about fines that went from $500,000 to nearly $3 billion in 4 years. That's a big change, right? That means people are scared. That means enforcers are seeing that they can make money off this. They're trying to figure it out. They're getting smarter, all those things, right? Now, a lot of you are in the room and you're like, well, we got them, right? $3 billion, that's a lot. I don't have $3 billion. Let me tell you how it works, okay? In a court case like this, it takes maybe 3 to 5 years to discover and articulate a problem. They then have to lay out the fine. They're gonna go back to court. They're gonna fight it. Google has billions of dollars. They're gonna be in court for 5 to 10 years. 10 to 15 years in, they're gonna have a $5 billion fine, or if their lawyers are good, which they are, it'll get reduced to $500 million. And in that same time period, Google will have made over $1 trillion, right? So, speed bump, oops, right? That's what it's gonna become. So fines don't really work. I think it's great that we're pushing on this, and I do hope that we start to see a cascading impact of fines. So for example, Italy fines something, and then Spain follows, and Denmark follows, and we have 30 different countries trying to grab, you know, $5 billion. That's maybe when you'll start to see some kind of impact. You know, the United States has different states doing it. But I don't think regulation is going to do it. So the other side of it is reputational, right? We as consumers, I think, feel powerless. That's what I hear a lot when I talk to people, that they feel powerless. They can't change things. But the reality is these companies need you as much as you need them. Right? If they don't have data from you, their value is zero. If they don't get value from you, if they don't get data from you for, let's say, 3 to 5 years even, their value starts to drop a lot. Data gets old. It's not as useful in age. You know, things change about your life that they need updates on. If they don't keep updated, or if you decide to use another platform at some point, you know, it's very possible it could slide away. So the topic I bring up is Cambridge Analytica, which I'm assuming most of you have heard of. Yeah, I see a lot of nodding. So Cambridge Analytica, if you were listening to the news a few years ago when this became a big thing, I think it was 2018, it was all about how Facebook got hacked, right? There was literally a movie on Netflix called The Great Hack that preceded The Social Dilemma. The problem with that branding of what happened is that it was never a hack. A hack is a security issue, and it was not. What happened was a breach of privacy. What happened was that Facebook allowed a researcher from Cambridge University to create a quiz that put on their platform legally through their API, access the data of the people who used or answered the quiz, and then also access the data of the users who were friends of those people who took the quiz. None of that was a hack. It was all legal. It may be a breach of your privacy because you feel uncomfortable about it, or you maybe didn't want your friends' data to be shared, or your data to be shared with your friends' data, but you consented to it. So actually none of that was illegal. And then he went and analyzed it. There's nothing wrong with that. The problem became when he sold the data to Cambridge Analytica. Again, a breach of contract in the terms of service, but not a security hack, as it was framed everywhere around the globe. Privacy is important, not just because of a bunch of controls, but because of the things that can happen after it gets into the wrong hands. It's something you can't control, right? I kind of tell people privacy is kind of, it's more like a mountain lion, right? Like if you've been in the mountains, probably a mountain lion's watching you at some point in your life, but you never know until it bites you in the butt, and then you're like, that hurt, right? That's not good. It's kind of like privacy, right? Someday you have your identity stolen and you lose a bunch of money. You have to fight to get that money back. That's painful. Someday a cop shows up to your door and says, that car that you drive, it was in the area where there was a murder. We subpoenaed Google. They gave us location data and your profile matches the criminal. So you go sit in a jail cell until they figure it out and prove you innocent. That's painful. Privacy is a military base getting exposed because the people on guard were running around and using Strava to track their fitness and reveal the risk of a military base. That's privacy. All that data was securely stored, securely transferred, securely shared, but it was a breach of privacy and trust. Okay? That's reputational impact. And Facebook's still trying to dig out of that, right? 5 years later, Facebook changed its name. It thinks we're Meta and you can't see us now, right? That's what they're trying to do. It's just not working very well. So the problem with privacy, and this is what I take to the businesses I talk to, is most of us just look into the companies that we're immediately sharing data with. Most privacy analysis or any kind of data protection impact assessment, transfer impact assessment, whatever they want to, you know, talk about that day, is focused on your immediate vendors. Who do you share data with? When in reality, it should be talking about not only do you share data with, but who do they share data with? How far does this go? How many people have access to it? When does it stop and what are the controls in place? Rather than as it works today, which is let's sign a contract and if you do anything bad, not my problem. Right. And that's something even GDPR doesn't protect against, right? And then the last one is consumer trust, and this is, you know, where you all come in. A lot of people in tech believe that they're very powerful. Like I showed you with the fines, it's not really going to make much of a dent in our business. And I agree, I don't think the fines are really going to change a whole lot. I think what will change is generational shift in the way we understand technologies and the increases in data literacy, just like literacy changed our world through the printing press and everybody having access to information and being able to make up their minds. Now, I bring that up because, of course, probably maybe you haven't seen this, but there are new technologies in the form of scarves and jackets and clothing nowadays that can mask you from surveillance. We'll actually inverse the print and make it so they can't actually see you. But most of you probably aren't going to go that far, and if you do, it might not be for 5 or 10 years. Then there's a much simpler way, which is what I do and a lot of people do, especially I've talked to a lot of younger people who do this, which is when I sign up for a service, my name is George Costanza, and my address is 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. That's the White House. And there's nothing they can do because it registers in their form as an appropriate name, an appropriate address. I fake it all. Then what? They can't target me. They have different information. They can definitely target me, but they can't target me as accurately. And over time, when we feed them fake data, it poisons their data sets. Their systems will change and adapt to all the information that they are given that is fraudulent at that point. So the service will probably erode over time, and if they don't have trust, that data is going to start to become less and less valuable. Now, that's just me, but you can also start to do this with the iPhone, right? iPhone's pushing privacy everywhere. And iPhone by default now has an email masking service built into it. And you can bet, if you're an iPhone user, that it's just going to get more and more over time. Okay, the iPhone, if they're really going to do privacy, which I guarantee you, they're just going to keep pushing that gas pedal, and here's why. Okay, Apple is a hardware company. Google is a data company. Apple stands no chance on catching up with Google because they have so much data. It's just inescapable. Now, that means Apple has to be privacy first. And in addition to that, if you look at their revenue, Apple's been working on their own advertising ecosystem. Their advertising revenue has gone up more than 10x in the last couple of years because now they sell privacy so that you use their service and all the data sticks within the Apple ecosystem and they can sell your data. That's what happens. So you can bet that Apple's going to make even more privacy-protecting tools that will mess with the Googles and the Facebooks and others of the world, but they're still going to have your data. And what else did I bring up? Oh, VPNs. Yeah, so I was in Nebraska back home, and I was shocked. I was teaching about 8 months ago back home. I asked these high schoolers, how many of you use a VPN? And actually, I'm interested. Yeah, here. A good portion of you. Like, I bet you 5 years ago, that wouldn't have been the case. Maybe 5-10% of the room would have raised their hands, right? So if you're using VPNs, you're using email masking, you're using all these tools that more and more is going to come out, my belief is at some point, companies will have to earn our trust, or their data is going to be worthless. And then their systems become worthless because they can't train an algorithm on fake information. They can, and it's going to operate totally different than if it was on properly sourced data that's of real value, right? So this is what I bring up to companies, is like, if your data is worth zero, your company's worth zero, right? So that's the work I've been doing to educate companies and help create change on strategy and principle rather than compliance. I think compliance is a good stick, I suppose, if you say a carrot and stick kind of model. It's a good way to kind of start to push the conversation, but it's not going to be the change that we all want to see. I think the change we all want to see is you showing up to meetings like this and becoming literate enough to advocate for yourselves day to day, understand what tools to purchase, how to use things differently, what to vote for when you do get to the ballot box and those opportunities are there. It comes from new companies getting created and operating differently to earn our trust by default and protect us by default in ways these companies never did. Everybody thinks the behemoths of the world they're here forever, and well, some of them may be, but also, you know, we've seen plenty of companies come and go. The MySpace, the Facebook. I believe in the antitrust world, you know, the way that they're looking at these investigations, Amazon will be the most likely to get broken up because it's very easy for the old school regulators to see like marketplace versus cloud service. Google probably won't get broken up. I think they're going to try, but they don't really know what they're looking at, and I don't think they understand the difficulty of enforcing what they're going to try to. That being said, I think Google's going to become more like an IBM. So IBM used to be the mainframe, the computer company that everybody knew, even in consumers. And now IBM, if I ask a 15, 20, 30-year-old, they have no idea what IBM is mostly, unless they're in tech. You know, but IBM's in everything still, right? IBM's the backbone of a lot of some of the biggest operations in our world. I think Google's going to head that way. And I think Facebook, because of what we talked about in trust, I think Facebook's going to slowly die off. I think they're already dying. That's why they forced us into Messenger about 5 years ago, because they knew Facebook Blue is going to die. Everybody's going to move to Instagram, and that's why they're frantically trying to get into the metaverse, because they understand that if they don't capture the next generation, their social platform's kaput. Which means, again, money's worthless. So that's kind of how I see things. Yeah, I've been doing this for quite some time, spoken about a lot of things, national news, broadcast questions, all this stuff. So hopefully that was informing. Hopefully that opened your mind to the things we're going to talk today. And if you have questions, scan that thing or just raise your hand. That also works for me. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I disagree a bit with the Apple story, because Apple has introduced client-side scanning. So companies like Apple being forced actually to do the dirty job before the encryption, so that the end-to-end encryption is actually jeopardized. So my question to you is, we are talking about the big platforms, but aren't also the kind of political entities hungry for data? Isn't it so beautiful to get this? I read 1984 many years ago. I'm 1 year older than Alex. This bidirectional TV, we smiled about that in the 70s and 80s, but now this is a bidirectional screen. So who is actually, who are the driving forces? Who are the hungry entities about data other than the big platforms? Because that's quite clear that they make money out of it. But there seem to be strong forces even in the public sector.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, that's kind of the point I brought up of like everybody's digitizing and it's just going to be part of life. I guess we could go down a rabbit hole of like who is behind it all and probably never find a result. But yeah, I can say like, yeah, when I'm drafting law, when I'm sitting in those rooms, it's very hard to get a regulator to say, yeah, we as a government should not be able to use it. We should regulate the companies, but I have elections to win and I have cities to surveil in order to protect society. It's very hard to get them to accept any responsibility. Yeah, that's also part of why I don't think regulation is going to solve all of this. You know, part of my goal with DataGrade, we're pretty young, but what we're trying to do is flip the surveillance on the surveillance companies. So we go and crawl the web, and we go and scan their network traffic, and we do a whole bunch of basically like pen testing level stuff to go in and analyze and build a report card of companies so that eventually consumers can come to us and see a rating just like you see a rating on a restaurant window, you know. That's my end goal. We help companies with third-party risk assessments. That's kind of the way we sell the company, the way that we earn money. And then we have a free model to where consumers can come in and see the grade and what are the alternative products I could use. If you want the depths of everything, you do have to pay us for that. But it's there, and it's affordable compared to like, you know, some other players in the market that they do this work, but they don't do it the same way we're planning to. We want to increase digital literacy. We want to make this more of a public service. But yeah, who's behind it all? Good question, right? Everybody's into data nowadays. And it's, I think, only going to become more valuable until maybe a certain point at which it's so prolific that it's going to start to deflate in value. We'll see. That might be decades out, though.
But you might need an open Android operating system.
Right. Yeah. Sure. Yeah.
Can I jump in before we get into questions? Hans is my student, and he said he's 1 year older than me. And I'm really conscious of the fact that many of these discussions get, you know, like it's the old guys speaking. So I literally want to, what I want to do first is, these guys are not props, okay? So in terms of Sophie and Alex, I'm going to give them some power for the time being. I want them to look at what's been coming in on Slido, choose up a couple of questions, whatever ones you are, and riff off with Joe, and then we'll go back to you guys. Is that okay? Okay? Because it's one of the critiques I keep on having from, you know, my obsession with information, whatever that is, and young people whom I have to teach, who sometimes tell me, like, move on, we know this stuff, okay? So I just want to get these guys. So over to you, Alex or Sophie, who's going to jump in now?
Okay, so this one's from an anonymous member of the audience, and I think it's a slightly personal advice question, either for the two senior members of the panel, and it's...
Thank you.
What is it?
Okay.
I don't miss my words. Can you really switch off in this digital society and not become a hermit?
That's a great question. I think the answer to that is no. Currently, you cannot, but yes, you should be able to. I am pretty binary. Now, I'm probably more connected than most of you in the room just because of the way I work and I'm flying all around the world and stuff, but like, and I have to be sometimes. But yeah, when I go out of the city or when I'm not working, I think my partner would tell you I'm very disconnected. I wouldn't consider myself a hermit, but I definitely, you know, I'll leave my phone at home. Sometimes I'll turn off my, you know, Bluetooth access because that's a bigger issue than you think when you walk around. People can get into your phone that way. Change your Wi-Fi networks. Don't be on public networks. Things like that. There's definitely things you can do to protect yourself without becoming a hermit. But can you get fully off grid and totally anonymous nowadays? No, not right now. No.
Sophie.
Yeah. So somebody asked, what is your opinion on surveillance capitalism and how it differs between the US and the EU?
Oh, hold on. One last thing on that last point too is, like, even if you do like get off or you think you are, you're not. That's another thing too, is like there's so much data that's created by you, even if you're not logged into a platform, or unless you pay in cash, you live in cities that don't have cameras, you just, your sensors everywhere. So just, yeah, that, I think you, but it goes back to, I think you should be able to.
So what's your opinion on surveillance capitalism and how it differs between the US and EU? So in the EU, we've got GDPR, yeah. In the US, we don't, so.
So I think a lot of Europeans I've spoken to, I feel that I hear a lot about how the US doesn't have any protections and all that, and it's kind of true, it's kind of not. We do have a lot of privacy laws, actually. They're just sectoral and state by state, and not as many like federal or national level controls. That being said, yeah, I mean, Europe has more stringent laws. Does that necessarily mean better? I suppose we'll see in 10 or 20 years. I do think there's a lot of things like, I don't know how many of you are into privacy law practicing or studying, but like, you know, the GDPR, for example, when it came out, and still I think to this day, it had derogation or like less crime, less punishment for, you know, companies with less than 250 people. Okay, so are you like reinforcing that companies should have less scale? Because Instagram was sold for $1 billion with like 15 employees, right? WhatsApp was a couple billion and it was like less than 30 employees. So it doesn't take more than 250 people to create serious problems. So, you know, like the laws aren't perfect here. It's and no law will be. I'm a big believer law is not going to solve these issues. But in terms of surveillance capitalism, I mean, yeah, you have more rights here for sure. There's more that's getting turned over. More rocks are getting turned over here for sure. There's bigger conversations. When I come over, I notice it's more accepted and interesting to people to talk about this stuff than in the United States. But there's definitely circles in the United States and changes happening. It's just in a different way.
You guys seen another question which you're dying to challenge Joe with before we go? And there's somebody at the back who's So I need to ask a question. Somebody does to ask a question? Somebody at back. Go. Yeah. Yeah, just stand up or riff or sing.
I think we can all agree that at least the Western world has never lived in so much excess. So human beings, once again in the Western world, are perhaps, like living a life of comfort, and they're becoming apathetic. And that anything to potentially, safeguard the fundamental human right of privacy becomes an inconvenience. Case in point, you go to a new website and you have to reject the cookies. Most websites, you have to go and tick each and every box saying, no, I don't want this particular data or to be collected about me, etc. Do you think this is intentional, that in order to safeguard our fundamental rights to privacy, we're being inconvenienced, that's becoming an annoyance to try and safeguard that particular right? And I think that can also apply to other fundamental human rights too. Of course, we're talking about privacy.
Well, let me start with data as a or privacy as a human right. I fundamentally believe that, but also that's a very European thing. United States, it's not looked at that way. And outside of, let's call it Europe and the United States, I'd say there's a lot of countries where they don't look at it that way. So human right is a definitely European stance. That being said, the inconvenience side of it, is it intentional? I don't think so. I think that is a byproduct of a group of governing bodies trying their hardest to make change, but lacking literacy and foresight into how those decisions may actually play out technically. We have a lot of lawyers who've been involved in drafting these laws, and legally the words make sense on paper, but when it comes to implementation and technical knowledge, they didn't really understand how that would play out, I would argue. And going back to the GDPR and is it the perfect law, there's a lot of places in the GDPR that actually reinforced the monopolies, made it harder to share, which means Google, Facebook at the time, if you look back on some of those, they were happy to not share their data, right? They're happy because the law said we can't, which means actually now we have an even stronger walled garden and you have to go through us to get stuff, So is it intentional? I don't know. I'm not out that far. But I think it's really just good intentions that turned into something that they weren't capable of predicting at the time.
Yeah. So my name is Anna, and I have three questions for you, if I may.
Can we do one at a time, just so I can keep track? Can we do one at a time? Or are they all interconnected?
More or less.
Oh, okay.
But I see this. Regulation. You've mentioned GDPR a few times. It links a little bit to the fundamental rights. It's not the only tool in our arsenal.
Right.
So from where we're standing, from within the EU, what we're trying to make is sort of make our market power count. Mm-hmm. So it's being supplemented with things like the Digital Services Act. We're working on a new one called the Media Freedom. They're all linked. And the idea is always there to protect us as people against the powerlessness. So you kind of, you leaned pretty heavy on saying regulation doesn't work. What else, what are the other options in our arsenal? So that's one of them. A little bit linked to this, and unless I miss something fundamental here, you sounded a little bit contradictory to me when you talked of legitimizing the data, fair enough, and I would love to hear more on what you think about that. But then in terms of consumer protection, then faking our data. So aren't we tainting something that we would then want to use legitimately? Where's the direction to go for in here? And very early on you said the program would have written itself. So this is the unrelated question, taking us to the next level. Is AI taking over? To what level is it taking over?
Okay. Let me try to tie those together.
It's a bit too much through.
Okay, so regulation. Yes, I'm aware you have the AI Act, you have the Digital Service Act, you have the EU privacy, there's a whole bunch of stuff here. Yeah, I am certified in the US, so I don't know the details of the European laws quite as much, but I am aware definitely. And I do know, yes, there's attempts to make it more comprehensive. I really appreciate the AI Act has a new risk level rather than a declarative of just like company size, right? Like a lot of privacy laws say companies over 50 million in revenue or certain threshold of users, things like that. I think that misses the point. You know, I think they're kind of, they're not meaningless, but they're a lot more meaningless than like what they've done in the AI Act, where they've actually tried to create like risk categories. And I think that's really important, and I hope more laws adopt some of those practices. The second question was a contradictory about poisoning data sets. Yes, sure, definitely could be contradictory. That's life, right? Like, there's gonna be new tools that get built. And so I believe, I'll give you an example. There's a tool I use called Plausible Analytics. It is a totally bootstrapped, they funded themselves, privacy alternative to Google Analytics, right? Now, if I'm using Plausible Analytics, why do I care if I poison Google Analytics? Maybe actually that's a better model for me because it helps push people towards Plausible or something like it, right? I'm just giving examples of companies I can name right now, but like there are new companies coming out all the time. Innovation in terms of building new technology is getting cheaper than ever before in regards to now there's this whole no code and low code movement to where like the average person can engage and build applications. You know, DataGrade, for example, I built the base MVP for probably 70 to 80% less than what it costs a traditional development cycle because I'm using a lot of these new modern tools, which I believe is gonna not only make it so that more people can code, because you don't actually have to fully code, and we can do it without having to rely on investment capital, which I think is one of the root causes of a lot of these problems too, is that previously, you know, you wanna go run a company, you gotta have a team of 5 engineers, you need to go get a couple $1 million, and most people don't have that. But if I can do it at home with a team of 2 or 3 of us, and it costs me, you know, $1,000 a month or something to maintain the architecture, like that's something a lot of people can do, you know? They can, it's not like it's cheap, but it's achievable without significant investment capital that's gonna be vicious and tell you how to run your business and all that stuff, right? So yes, maybe in the near term it's contradictory, but actually it's, in my opinion, the scale at which that would have to happen. If I start telling you to do it now, that scale might not be reached for 10 or 20 years anyway, right? We'll see, but also like my partner's from Beijing and in China, I can tell you like what she's told me is that there's a lot of people who wear, you know, face covers to avoid surveillance and do different things, the way that they act in public, the way that they talk and write on their apps to protect their privacy, but also to protect their social credit score. All that is a demonstration that people will fake information if it's in their best interest, right? That's all. And the last point was what? Can you remind me of the third question? AI taking over. Right.
The machines.
I am of the opinion AI is only going to get more prominent in society. I am of the opinion we should be sharing, we should be leveraging data, we should be creating products, and that AI is very valuable to society. I also believe, though, AI will not replace, it will enhance us. Yes, some AI will replace us, right? Like burger flipping, you know, not a super sexy job. Yes, it's a low end, like it's an accessible entry level job, but like, you know, of course, economics is going to take over in some senses. In a small town, I have a property in a small town in Colorado. They have an ice machine outside. It's fully automated. Like, yeah, you plug in water, you have a system do the thing. But then there's the opposite side of like white collar work, right? Mathematics, accounting, all this stuff. Like, yeah, there's going to be a lot of AI because computers are best at math. That's literally how they work. It's all math. So yeah, are they going to take over those jobs? I actually don't think so. Same with like doctors, lawyers. I don't think they're going to take over the jobs. I think they're going to enable those workers to do a higher volume of work. They are going to bring insights that maybe were never considered before. They're going to amplify our human intelligence, but you're always still going to need a human in the loop to like send the signature. And perhaps what that leads to, especially like let's talk about like doctors, is a world where we have less specialists and we have more generalists. People who know how to treat and use anesthesia and different things, but like the machine helps them diagnose because the machine can have a whole cascading intelligence of all the diseases and who has it and how they all connect. And that won't necessarily automate their jobs, but it might take them from a salary of $250,000 a year to $150,000 a year, and they're gonna feel like they've been replaced. So there's also that, right, where it's not full replacement, it's augmentation, and it changes people's lifestyles. But that being said, I also think it's gonna create jobs, right? My parents, right now, they run a company ever since they left the post office. They do automotive, they fix cars, right? They sell cars, and I'm confident. I've helped them rebuild their business over the last half decade. It's not going to be AI that replaces those mechanics. It's just not. They can do some of it. They can take tires off. They can do a few things, but like the level of nuance, or plumbers, right? I have cousins that are plumbers. You telling me all the plumbing that's in the ground within the next 10 or 20 years, they're going to rebuild and standardize all the plumbing in the world? Like, no. There's going to be jobs that stick around. In addition, going back to the mechanic example, we didn't have mechanics until the car. Right? We're going to create jobs out of this. We are humans. We innovate. We create change, and then we adapt. Maybe this is moving faster than a lot of people are comfortable with. Definitely a problem. But I think we will bridge the gap, and that's part of why I do this. That's part of why I educate governments. I do think we need funding from the government to help prepare that transition. My concept of data taxation bill that I took to New York, and it actually got to the Senate, just hasn't got a lot of movement, but the point of it was that we tax operationalized valuable data in companies. We take that money, we send it back into society in the form of technology resources in public schools, so they're buying computers, tablets, whatever for kids in schools that may not be able to afford it. You're building an education system to help transition adults who may, you know, have their job either taken or augmented, and they want to pivot their career, because you can't, I think the biggest problem we could potentially run into, I'm not worried about killer machines, I'm worried about a world in which we have mass layoffs, like we're seeing now, and you have 40 to 60 year olds who are told to go back to college. I think that's my biggest fear, because you can't do that. You can't require that out of people. If they want to, great, but like, we gotta have some system to bridge it. And then the third part of it was that the excess money would go towards PSAs, public education, similar to how big tobacco was fought in the United States. We actually, I don't know how much any of you know about that, but big tobacco got pushed away in the early 2000s, mostly because there were so many lawsuits against them, and that money was funneled into public education campaigns. That changed it. So our smoking rate in the United States went from like 42-43% down to like 11%. So. Didn't get rid of it, but it eliminated a lot. So that's kind of, I guess, to try to answer all three, that's about where I sit.
Can I dive into something first? Just ask a question, okay? How many of us are into education here? Quite a few, yeah? Quite a few, okay, just to get the range check. How many are students? Any students feeling nervous about their job prospects? I mean, I'm teaching the digital arts students, okay? Mm-hmm. And I think I was asked by somebody like, you know, what's going to happen to my job? Am I looking at things the wrong way? And I think, and yet, I'm with all the ChatGPTs and Bards and things like that. Again, I've also seen the education systems worldwide, right? That they've gone from either mass hysteria assessments, what do we do, yeah? Back to pen and paper. I've heard several people, even within my faculty, saying it's going to be exams and literally, they handwrite because they're all going to cheat. And on the other side, you have people saying, I've just been through a three-year course, four-year course at university. Where am I going to work? Now, in Malta, we have a strange system, okay? We actually, a lot of people have jobs waiting for them. It's not the same in many other parts of the world. But this sense of discomfort, I don't know if you guys are feeling it. Those of us who are in the education sector, okay? I know you wanted to ask something.
As in someone who's into adult education and lifelong education, I think radicalization is the nemesis of lifelong education. You're still teaching and learning, but something that obviously is, you know, the arch enemy of what we are there for. Mm-hmm. And you've mentioned some strategies or coping strategies or resistance strategies against being identified, mm-hmm. and having your data stored and misused. But what about radicalization? That is so powerful, and it's so subtle. Like, mm-hmm. I look, for example, at my partner's feed on his social media, and it's like I'm living in a different world, and yeah. we live in the same house. It's so scary. I mean, no wonder we are disagreeing on something that happened in Malta, which is a tiny island,
yeah.
because his feed is telling him something completely different from mine.
Do you want to put context? So, do you know who her partner is?
Okay.
Okay. John Malia is making a living from
yes,
being a podcaster. Which is something he would not have done a couple
without
of years
without media. So we're yeah. really right, right. not the family against, you know, those who's scared of media. Yeah, like yeah. we venture into it, we try to use it as an asset.
It's, yeah.
So that's really scary, and I would like you to expound a little bit on the radicalization
sure,
risks.
Sure, sure. So I talked to them a bit earlier, and I told him a little bit too. Like, I'll preface with, like, I'm not a specialist in dis and misinformation. Part of the reason I didn't follow that path is I believe it is a never-ending rabbit hole. I don't believe there's a business model around it, and I don't think artificial intelligence or automation is going to help. A little bit, but not to which you're hoping. The reason I got into data privacy is because I actually think the value of data is the root cause of those issues. I think those are secondary factors that happen because what you're talking about, let's go back to the attention economy and how attention turns into data into money, right? So what I explained to the antitrust investigators was, hey, I know you don't understand this this attention economy, but you can see that they're destroying competition. You can see the lack of access to resources, right? They control the data, they don't share it. You can't share from Instagram to Twitter, all those things. But they don't understand the money. I said, so think about the way that they get money. They get us to pay attention, which then turns into data, and then money. So when they create an addictive interface, the purpose of that addiction is to get us to pay more attention. It is not to build an addiction. Those companies didn't say, I want the whole world to be addicted to my platform, right? They didn't say, I want young women to be committing suicide at a higher rate than ever before. They said, we need more data. How do we get people to pay more attention? Now, from an antitrust perspective, that's how they make money. So in the attention economy, where they've taken the fiscal price to zero, when they create an addiction, they are actively and intentionally raising the price of their platform. They're price gouging in their own attention marketplace. So the reason I got into understanding and mapping risk and value of data is because I believe if we can legitimize the value of data, not all, but a lot of those issues will start to fade away over time because it will cost them money to get you to create content. Right now, it's the most effective and efficient business model in the history of the world to create fake information, right? Now, your ethics may be holding you back from doing that, but the fact of the matter is right now it's all legal. And it's great business, right? The election interference in the United States got blamed on Russians, you know, 5-6 years ago. Okay. There's also millions of people all around the globe who are making thousands of dollars a day to make fake information that people click on. And the reason Facebook allows that to proliferate is because they want your attention. They want your data. If it costs them money to get your data, or to pay for your content, they would change their mind, right? I think that's a big thing a lot of people don't really think about. Like if the internet was a highway that we were all driving on, and on the side of that highway there was a car accident that we all looked at, which we all do, right? We all look at that car accident. If that was the case, the internet would think we need more car accidents the way it's designed, right? That's just because they want attention. They don't have any qualitative or quantitative metric that they can take to Wall Street other than we have more people or we have people watching longer, or both, we have more people watching longer. That's literally their business model. So I wrote about this in my book, but I believe these companies, they're just worth significantly less than what they claim. The productive value to society is not billions and trillions of dollars. It may be actually retracting billions of dollars from society, but that math is not calculatable at this point in history because it's such a black box. So yeah, to go back to like your question on mis and disinformation, I I think it really, at this point in history, and until we resolve some of those issues, I think it comes down to data literacy in classes. But also, like, think about, you know, when the printing press came out, guaranteed there's lots of mis and disinformation, right? For the longest time, we had to listen to whoever was literate when they read to us. You think they never told a lie? You know, the problem is the scale. The problem is the targeted aspects of it. Some things I've proposed is to try to calm that, not only the risk and the value concepts, but also a few things. Number one, we should go back to chronological order timelines. So it shouldn't be algorithm-based. That happened in the mid-2010s because all these companies had, they used to have a discover tab. It was like, discover this content, discover it. But nobody clicked on it. Nobody wanted to use it. So they just jammed it into our timeline and had an algorithm sorted out for us. Okay? If we had chronological timelines, I would argue this would not be near as bad. Number two, inline or native advertisements, I think, need to be made distinct. If I pulled up my Instagram timeline and I scrolled through like the average person does, which is very rapid, guaranteed none of you know what the difference between a sponsored or a promoted post versus one that you actually followed, right? Because it's designed in a way that they call native or inline advertising, and it is literally designed with the purpose of looking just like another post. That shapes our mind. But if you go on Instagram right now, you open your phone, look at it, and scan through those posts and actually count, there's an ad like every 3 to 5 posts, depending on your platform that you're using. But you probably don't notice it because it's so targeted, so accurate, that it looks like something you may have already followed. That's the problem. We've had ads in newspapers, we've had ads in phone books, we've had ads on TV, and it was a great business model.
It was a business model, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't have a problem with advertising as a revenue model. I have a problem with advertising as the only revenue model, and I have a problem with advertising that is so hard to distinct from content that I liked or followed that it alters my perception of reality.
What I'd like to do is the next 5 minutes, that's all we've got, I think, left, okay? So if you guys have seen anything there which really struck you, just go for it. Then if there's one last question, whatever, you guys are begging, it's okay.
Okay, so you and I were having a conversation earlier about how the internet could get segregated maybe in the years to come. So different regions of the world would have their own kind of ecosystems, and you could kind of move between them if you're a bit of an international type. So the one that I want to talk to you about, because I've got multiple questions on, and I want to talk to you about just in general, is TikTok, your general opinion and feel for the platform, and just the Chinese information space at the moment. So how that's going to play out over the next few years, you think?
We being the United States, or we being like Europe too? I don't know. Europe have a problem with China? I don't know the relationship with China very well over here.
I'd say the information space that we live in, because I feel like the American and the European information space is very interlinked.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, definitely. I mean, we provide a lot of services over here too, so... So let me try to succinctly talk about that. A couple years ago, I forget the exact date, but the European Union was created a contract with Huawei. There you go. I'm very American. To bring in telecom infrastructure from China to Europe, within 6 months, Europe had pulled out of that deal. You think that's because the infrastructure that China was providing wasn't good? No, it's because they realized, like I said, the regulators had the best intentions in mind, get non-US, have some competitors, let's bring in China's. Oh shit, we're gonna put surveillance on everybody, it's gonna go directly to the Chinese nationals, right? TikTok, again, it's contentious. It is a Chinese-owned company. They have operations in different countries, but it's been proven time and again that they are not following their own terms and privacy policies, as they've stated. Whether we can trust that TikTok is not being used as surveillance on society, I think is not something you should fall for. I think you definitely shouldn't trust it. I think that it is the biggest surveillance tool to come out of China and ever. people need to be careful. But again, there's a lot of fun to be had on TikTok too, so try to convince your kids otherwise, right? Like, I don't know. There's not a lot you can do. You can try to ban it. It's just not gonna happen probably. It might, but yeah, in terms of infrastructure, right, like you're talking about multiple webs. So I used to work with the World Economic Forum, and a big discussion we used to have is at some point we won't have the physical nation state jurisdictions as much as we'll have internet jurisdiction. So there will be like a United States internet, a European internet, a Chinese internet, maybe an Indian internet, and then like the dark web, you know. And those will be the territories more than it would be like, you know, Malta, Italy, you know, all different countries. I think we're already starting to see that, right? We've talked about regulation in Europe a lot. Europe's definitely trying to create its own way of operating on the internet, which is great. It's comprehensive, as you mentioned. Could cause problems. I've had friends here in Germany when at one point Germany was trying to oust the Facebook Messenger. She's like, I don't know how I'm gonna contact some of my friends in other countries, you know. Australia, for example, a couple years ago tried to ban, I believe it was Facebook from providing news, or I forget exactly what it was, but anyway, they tried to say, or maybe it was like, you got to take down fake news within like 72 hours or something like that. It was something that not super achievable. And Facebook just pulled out of Australia. And within like 48 hours, Australia was like, bring it back. Like, we need it. We can't go back to the 90s. You know, it's very cost intensive to go rebuild that infrastructure. So it's going to be a complicated dance to figure out, you know, who has that power and how do we get it to be safe and respectable. And again, that's why so much of my work is focused on digital literacy, because I think just like literacy 500-600 years ago-ish, right? As the printing press came out and started to proliferate the ability to read, we need to make our kids and our current society digitally literate. And it will take a long time, but we have to start now. And because of the internet, I think it can happen faster than any other time in history, right? It's not like we have to have a distribution channel that ships out books everywhere. It's like we can make the content online. We can scale this very fast, just the way that we stood up the internet over 2 decades. So will we be literate 2 decades? Probably not. But with the proper support mechanisms and government and education systems, with the appropriate content that is that properly engages people, right? People tell me all the time the social dilemma should have had more ways to fix things and different things like that. Like, that was not the point of our work. The point of our work was to bring a problem up in an artistic way and to have others build upon it. You know, part of our fear of creating solutions in that film was that it would be looked upon as a gold standard. And at that point in history, we hadn't had enough data to test things. So who are we? How much better are we if we just say, hey, go do this, it's gonna fix the world, when we didn't even have time to do our proper research, right? Like, So I think really what's happening is all these facts have been cemented over the last decade, right? If we call like Edward Snowden like the big bang in surveillance, and then you were either Edward Snowden's a criminal, or you were like, that's the best thing that ever happened. Then you had Cambridge Analytica, the great hack. Then you had the social dilemma. The social dilemma is still to this day the most watched tech documentary in the history of the world. We had 38 million people watch it in the first month. We were number one in every single developed nation across the world for a month straight. Netflix said most films, entertainment, not just documentaries, will do this for 3 to 5 days, maybe a week. We did it for a month. And we've now reached, I think, very close to like 1.5 billion views in 3 years. That, to me, doesn't mean that we were successful. It means that society was concerned and literate enough to understand the problem, and we created a message that connected with them, that resonated with a moment in history. Mm-hmm. And that is to be built upon forever, till we pass away, till our children pass away. It's going to be a long time, but we have to start somewhere.
We're going to close off now. This has been a talk about data, privacy, and I'm hoping it was about information. We're obsessed with information. From where we are, most educators are. Most of life is never in black and white, but in different shades of gray. We are navigating various shades of gray right now, okay? But as long as we're kicking around, we're gonna try and keep on going for trying to think sideways, okay? Thanks, Joe, for coming over. It was really fun having you.